In the last few years, Phil and I have watched as God has birthed and matured a powerful vision in the heart of my older brother, Jeff Keaton. That vision, now known as Renewination, is focused entirely on the need to give today's children a biblical worldview. You may be thinking, what exactly is a biblical worldview? Well, it's pretty simple. In our world, we have a secular worldview, and we have a biblical worldview. The secular worldview is where the culture dictates how we should think, how we should act, and how we should live. On the other hand, a biblical worldview is where God's Word tells us how we should think, how we should act, and how we should live. If we ever needed to teach children God's truth, I think you all would agree with me that today is that day. With all of the craziness in our world, all of the bad news that you hear out there, I can honestly say that Renewination is like a breath of fresh air, as they are literally giving thousands of children a biblical worldview and have done so even in just the past few years. Because this has been one of our passions in raising our own family, Phil and I and the entire Collingsworth family feel honored to be a ministry partner with Renewination, and we would love for you to get more acquainted with their work. There are a couple of ways that you can do that. First, before you leave the concert, make sure you go by the product table and pick up a free copy of their national magazine called The Renewination Review. The magazine you'll find on the table tonight is one that is called a special Collingsworth Family Edition magazine, where Renewination has included a lot of family pictures, stories, and write-ups about each individual family member. But more important than that, you'll also find articles in that magazine that will help you better understand a biblical worldview and how you can pass that on to your children and grandchildren. Also, back at the product table, you will find Renewination's latest book titled Biblical Worldview, What It Is and Why It Matters, written by Dr. Josh Mulvihill. I think you will find this book very helpful, and tonight you can include that book as one of the items in any of our package deals, so make sure you check that out. One more thing that is really one of the most exciting things that has happened at Renewination recently is the launch of their online Christian school, Illuminated. I'm going to be honest with you. I've homeschooled my kids for a total of 19 years. And when I found out about the launch of Illuminated, I thought to myself, what would I have given to have had this resource available to me when I was in the trenches back in the day trying to homeschool my kids? Illuminated is an online school that has live teachers, excellent academics, and biblical worldview training in every class. If you know anyone who is interested in this, or you yourself are interested, you can go to homeeducate.org to find out more. Again, that is homeeducate.org. In closing, I'd just like to say one more thing. I'm one of these people that still believes that God wants to do something great in our day. I don't believe for one moment that God is up in heaven, wringing his hands and distraught about the state of our world. Oh, I believe it saddens his heart greatly the way our world is. But let me tell you what I believe he's doing. I believe that he's calling men and women all over this world to get involved in the restoration of our fallen world. And that is exactly what Renewination is doing. They are laser focused in gaining access into the hearts and the minds of millions of children and helping them to see all of life, not through a secular lens, but through a biblical lens. Now that is a mission that we all can and should get behind. Thank you all for listening, and we'll see y'all in a few moments.
Well, Merry Christmas. Man, it's so good to see you here this evening, and welcome for you that are online. We are excited to have the Collingsworth family here to do a Christmas celebration concert here with us. And so we're glad to have them, and they are going to come out here in just a few minutes. So I've always wanted to say this: sit back and relax and enjoy the show.
Thank you. single flurry.
I said to Dewey with a hurry, climb down the chimney, put up the brightest string of lights I've ever seen. Slice up the fruit cake. This time we hung some tinsel on that evergreen vine. But I've grown a little leaner, grown a little colder, grown a little sadder, grown a little older, and I need a little angel sitting on my shoulder. Need a little
come Merry Christmas. Let your heart be light. From now on, our troubles will be out of sight. Have yourself a merry little Christmas. Make the Yuletide gay. From now on, our troubles will be miles away. Here we are, as in olden days, happy golden days of yore. Faithful friends who are dear to us, gather near to us once more. Through the years, we all will be together. If the Lord allows, hang a shining star upon the highest bough, and have yourself a merry little Christmas now.
Batavia, Ohio. Wow, the Collingsworth family have been all across the nation, and are we ever more excited to be in our hometown tonight. What a great way to end our Christmas tour this year, and so wonderful to see each one of you. I've told every one of those 11 crowds along the way, there are two sounds to me that sound like Christmas. The first one is the Salvation Army bell. I love the first time I hear the ringing of that bell, I automatically go looking for dollar bills and change and anything I got to stuff in there. The second sound I love at Christmas, and it notes to me Christmas is underway, is when I hear a crowd like this sing together. You didn't know when you stepped through those back doors tonight, you became an automatic member of the Glen Estee Tabernacle Choir. So the person next to you may be going to get to hear you sing for the first time. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to forget they're sitting there and sing like you sing in the shower at home. Because we're going to sing joy to the world. We do have something to have joy about this year. Amen. Joy to the world. The Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. Thing, nearly every person has an opinion on what their favorite Christmas carol or Christmas song is. And I'm no different. I have my favorite. And since I've got the microphone, I'm going to have you sing my favorite. It came upon a midnight clear, that glorious song of old, from a angels bending near the earth to touch their hearts of gold. Peace on the earth, goodwill to men, from heaven's all gracious King. The world in song. Name above all names, beautiful Savior, glorious Lord, sing that. Jesus, name above all names, beautiful Savior, glorious Lord. Blessed Redeemer, Living Word. Sing it again. Jesus, name above all names, beautiful Savior, glorious Lord. Let's worship him together this evening. Amen. Olivia, you get started.
Thank you.
Make a Presbyterian shout on a Sunday night. Hallelujah. It was December the 20th of 2019, last year, the very end of our 20th year of music ministry, and our very final requirement of the year, our very final booking of the year, happened to be one that this crew back here will never forget. We usually don't have to be at a venue at 6:50 a.m., but that was an unusual venue. It was the White House in Washington, D.C., and we were so honored to be asked to sing at the White House last year for Christmas. Wow. I have to admit, it's the first time I ever saw this crew come rolling out of their hotel rooms ready for business at 5:30 a.m. The bus was sitting on 8th Street at 6:50, and right at 7 a.m., the big gates to the White House opened, and we pulled the bus up in there, through the metal detectors, and in we went. Our assignment for that day was to sing 2.5 hours of Christmas music while Mrs. Trump had a reception for all of the federal employees and their families. And those kids came dressed to the nines, let me tell you. Hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of folks came through. They set us up in the historic East Room of the White House. They even had a big sign, had our name on it, said Collingsworth Family, Bethel, Ohio. Well, you can see George looking over our shoulder there. Kim, it looks like he's having us hold out a note to me. It was an amazing day. We finished singing, and whoever was coming through the East Room at that moment, they started clapping, and then a fella from the back row, he yelled out, "How'd you get this gig?" It was a wonderful morning, and one of the things I loved was the fact that they put no restrictions on us, what we could sing or what we couldn't sing. And I have to be honest with you, I gave them all the Jesus I could give them, let me tell you. It was a wonderful day. And to stand in that historic place and sing that song right there. The angels called him Jesus, but I call him Lord. Whew, that was a wonderful privilege and an honor. Now, I understand 2020 is one of those years that if it was a fish, I can guarantee what you'd do with it. You'd throw it back. It's been that way all across the country. Folks feel the very same everywhere we've gone. And this tour has taken us all the way from Branson, Missouri to way out in Bremen, Georgia, all across the country. Folks all feel the same. But I tell you what, let's do tonight. It'll be there when we get back to it here in the next few moments. So let's just take the next hour and a half and forget about 2020. It's Christmas time. Let's do some celebrating tonight. Miss Emma, come up here. I'm going to introduce you, and then I'll introduce your bodyguard here in just a minute. This is Miss Emma. She's 6 years old. She's in kindergarten. And my, did she sing beautiful or what? Now, you see, she is qualified to have her own Secret Service agent. And he goes everywhere she goes. His name is Winston. It's her little brother. First night or two on the tour, we had her come out alone, and he stood back there till she was finished. He understood quickly as she was getting much more FaceTime than he was, and he complained heartily. So the next night he came out with his penny in his hand. They took off singing, and the penny got dropped, and across the stage it went. She was very distracted, missed some words, so I told him, go get the penny, and we'll start over again. One night, they forgot to send him to the bathroom before he came out. So that was an exciting night. It's been an exciting night every night. Hey, everybody, make Winston and Emma welcome here tonight. Say hi to them, Winston. Hey, before you go, Miss Emma, let's do one more song that you learned right at the beginning of COVID. We love this one.
He's got the whole world in.
Excellent job. We'll see you later, okay? Wow. You can't imagine how exciting that is every night. We don't know if they'll show up, if they'll show up on time, or what condition they'll show up in, but it's going to be fun, let me tell you. We started the year of 2020 with two grandchildren. That was them right there. We're ending the year with five. What you guys laughing at down there? Wow. I'm telling you what. So, Philip, you got the year started right. You added first, you and Charlene, and there he is, little Miss Mr. Noah Timothy, and here he comes right now. Who built the ark? Noah, who built the ark, brother? He loves that, his favorite song. So, Noah Timothy was born January 31st. And he's almost 11 months old. This is Charlene, Philip's wife, and this beautiful little son of theirs. Make them welcome here tonight. I think Charlene, he's pretty spoiled tonight. He's got his other grandma here as well. So he's in deep clover tonight, let me tell you. Hey, you've heard some beautiful music already coming from our daughter, Olivia. She's our youngest. She's 22 years old. That beautiful singing and that guitar. Make Olivia welcome tonight. Say hey to everybody, Olivia. Now, you could tell by looking that the Collingsworth family is expanding. What are y'all laughing at? Man, it's been an exciting 11 concerts. Every night, special prayer. Lord, we know we have a new baby coming, but don't let it be tonight. And you've made it all the way to the end. An amazing trooper, Brooklyn. Wow. Don't say that. He said, we're not done yet. Well,
as far as I'm concerned, he can come at about An hour and a half.
Oh, wow. So you have two little ones, you and William. William's our front of house engineer right back there taking care of the sound. You saw Winston and Emma, but tell us about number three.
So this is our little tiebreaker, another little boy, and his name will be Wellington Henry Blair, and the kiddos have nicknamed him Baby Wells. So yeah, I'm actually about 20 minutes from my hospital, and my doctor is on call tonight for all you ladies out there that are worried about me. Thank you very much.
You wouldn't believe the sympathy that has come her direction this week. And I just got up and said every night, Lord, will you all help me pray that this baby is not born in Tulsa, Oklahoma in a bus beside the road? And the Lord has been wonderful. So Brooklyn, we are so excited. Wellington Henry Blair. Doesn't that sound like it came out of Buckingham Palace? I mean, that's going to be something. Make William and Brooklyn, Winston and Emma and Wellington welcome tonight. Courtney is our alto singer. You've heard from her a bunch already tonight. Her husband, Michael, right there. He's back there putting his own picture on the screen right now. He's our media director. And Michael and Courtney has some of the most exciting news to tell. So let it out of the bag. Tell us, Courtney.
So we just booked our flights last week, and we will be leaving on February the 6th to go to Thailand to adopt our first son, and his name is Theo, and he's 17 months old.
Wow. We were hoping you could show a picture, but tonight we're broadcasting a live stream, and since the fact he's a Thailand citizen, they can't do that yet. So, but tell us about his entire name.
So his entire name is Theodore Michael Tawin Metz. Poor guy.
Where does Tawin come from?
Tawin was his original Thai name, and it means a person of purity. And then his new name, Theo, means a gift from God.
And he certainly is, for sure. So you started this process how long?
Let's see, it's been 3 years ago this month, so in December 2017, and then Theo was born in the middle of our adoption process in June of 2019.
And the Lord knew every bit of that. You would start 3 years ago, now he's only 17 months old at this point, and he's coming home back to the United States in the month of, well, it'll be 1st of March before you'll get home with him. And can you imagine a little boy from Thailand getting to ride a big black bus all across the United States? Is this going to be exciting or what? Hey, congratulate Michael and Courtney tonight. I can't hardly look at a picture of Theo or talk about him without crying. They'll say, there goes Dad again. He's crying. It's going to be an exciting day when he lands at that airport and we get to see him for the first time. Well, Brooklyn, you've got a lot of sympathy in this crowd right here. You only have a week till that baby is due, but he could come at any time. You can sit and sing if you wanted to, but she thinks she can do it. It's easier to breathe than she stands up. We do Christmas like we mean it. We're serious about Christmas. Sing it, girl.
We huddled up in January around the roaring fire. Then spring arrived and everything turned green. We made a thousand memories beneath the summer skies. October found us walking hand in hand through autumn leaves. Now once again we're braced for winter weather. Every time we get together, we do Christmas like we mean it.
Like we mean it.
If a carol needs singing, then we sing it.
If we forget a note to rhyme,
then we'll just wing it.
We do Christmas like we mean it.
We're trimming up the tree, and packages are waiting at our door. The secrets and surprises that seem so hard to keep
up all kinds of love and making room for more. Inviting in the joy.
We do Christmas like we mean it.
We mean it.
Somebody have a Methodist shouting spell in the middle of sleigh ride. Did you all hear two or three blind mice get loose in there somewhere? Wow. Now, she and I have been married for 34 years. I've watched her play the piano for 37 years that I've known her. And it's first time ever in history I ever saw her become completely fascinated with another arranger's piano piece. She's always done her own arranging. She always plays her own arrangements. But she saw a Steinway artist playing this arrangement on YouTube, and I saw her set her jaw. She was watching that and watching it, and she goes, "Oh, that is not humanly possible." But the next week, here came the score. She ordered it. It arrived at the house, 162 measures of music. She laid that all out on the piano, and what did she say? But she said, "That is not humanly possible." But I saw her begin to set her jaw and start rehearsing. And a gentleman from Long Island, New York, he's an attorney, and there's a good chance he may be even watching tonight. He's a friend of ours. Now his name is Andrew Gentile. And did he ever make an arrangement like nothing? Kim, just give us a little bit about that lesson you had on FaceTime with you and Andrew Gentile.
Well, he gave his contact information to our record company when we applied for the mechanical license. And so he said, you know, if she needs any help at all or has any questions, he said, here's my information. He said, and be sure and tell her this is a marathon, not a sprint. I was like, I already found that out. I need to talk to him. So he called me, and we got on FaceTime. I had my first piano lesson in 40 years, an hour and 50 minutes long. It was awesome, and it was fascinating. He kept saying things. We went over every measure, and he'd say things like, Kim, you're going to have to throw your wrist. You just got to throw it. Just loosen your hand and throw your wrist at that piano. And I was like, oh, we don't throw our wrist in gospel music. We had a good laugh, and honestly, it has been a fascinating journey. He said to me, because I really don't know anything about this type of music that you sing, but he said, I've been searching you all over YouTube, and he said, since you applied for this license, and he said, you know, it's amazing. He said, I've just been listening to your family over and over, and he said, there's a place for this kind of music y'all do. I said, you think? Yeah, come to Glen Estee and hear their choir. You'll know that there's a lot more in this world. And so we have struck up a friendship. He has kept up with us through the entire pandemic. I believe he's listened to every single live stream we've done, because every time that we finish one, I get a nice long email or a letter from him saying, I like this and I like this, or talking about the music. And I was like, wow, he's still listening to this stuff. So I think it's fascinating. And let me tell you one other thing. He said, I want to come hear your family sing. I said, okay. He said, I live in Long Island. And he said, I looked on your schedule, and he said, I'm a lawyer, and he said, I've tried many cases in Brooklyn, New York, and I said, you're going to be in Brooklyn. He said, you're going to be at a place called the Brooklyn Tabernacle. He said, I've never heard of that place. And I said, okay. And I said, have you ever heard of the Brooklyn Tabernacle Choir? And he said, no, I haven't. I said, oh, that's the perfect place. So I said, you just come on, you'll love it. So he got on a subway, took him 2 hours to get across to Brooklyn. He came for the third service, and it was an amazing time we had there, just amazing. The presence of God was very, very real. And afterwards, he ran up to me, and he goes, wow. He goes, this was nothing like my church. I was like, most churches aren't, Andrew. But anyway, we talked about the choir. He was taken with the choir and loved that. And a few weeks later, he called me, and he said, you know, I've been searching and learning so much. He said, and I found this woman on YouTube. Her name is Sandy Patty. I said, Andrew, you've never heard of Sandy Patty? And he said, well, I've heard her name, but I've never heard her sing. He said, it's just amazing. He wanted to immediately know, who is David Clydesdale, he said. And you would know, Alan, exactly who I'm talking about. He's an amazing orchestrator and arranger. And I said, I need to meet this man. So it has been fascinating to strike up a friendship with Andrew Gentile And me learning Sleigh Ride introduced me to Andrew, which in turn introduced Andrew to gospel music. And I think that is an amazing thing how God works. So.
Hey, tell them about that fingering, what Andrew told you about your brain going into a pretzel.
Well, he said the fingering on this piece. You say, why is this piece so hard? It's very simple why it's so hard. That didn't make a lick of sense, but anyway. He said, your brain, what fingering is required in this piece, he said, your brain was never intended to do this. I said, thank you very much. He said, you just have to do it over and over and over and over again, because when you do not rehearse that often, your brain literally forgets the way it's supposed to be, because your fingers never were designed to do that. So,
wow. That's what you call putting your brain in a pretzel, for sure. But man, what comes out the other end is fantastic. Did you all enjoy Sleigh Ride? Wow. If you ever studied any kind of literature, you'll recognize immediately an American poet by the name of Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. He lived 150 plus years ago. He would never have dreamed about what 2020 would be like, but he lived right through the Civil War. The year 1863 was a very rough year for Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. His wife was tragically killed in a terrible fire. As the year drew toward the end, his son left home and went to join the Union Army because the Civil War was taking place. There was hate everywhere. There was no peace. There was division and strife. Does that sound familiar for 2020? There was fear. There was everything like we're experiencing this year. On Christmas morning in 1863, near his home, the church bells began to chime. And he said he couldn't help himself. He sat down, got his quill pen, and he began to write, not knowing that the poem that he was writing would become a classic Christmas hymn. And it means more today than it ever has. You'll recognize these words. What a beautiful message. Listen.
I heard the bells on Christmas Day, their old familiar carols play, and wild and sweet the words repeat of peace on earth, goodwill to men.
Sleep. Hi, everyone. I would love to share with you what I believe is the greatest story ever told. The story of the first Christmas. Now, if you would, imagine yourself over 2,000 years ago, standing on a hillside near a little town in Judea. If you look over in the distance, you'll see a man slowly leading a donkey down the road. His name is Joseph. Sitting on the back of the donkey is a young lady named Mary. They've been on a very long journey, and they're heading for that little town near where you're standing. Something very special will take place there tonight, for this is the little town of Bethlehem. Joseph into the town, you'll see that it's getting dark, and all of the rooms in all of the inns are taken. But one innkeeper tells them they can spend the night in a stable nearby. This is where that something special will take place. You see, inside that stable, a baby boy is born to Mary and Joseph, whom they call Jesus. They have no baby's crib, so Mary puts little Jesus to sleep in the soft hay of a manger. Imagine that you leave that peaceful scene in the stable and head back out to the hillside. There you see a group of shepherds tending their flocks. All of a sudden, the shepherds become frightened, for the skies above are instantly filled with a great light. Then you hear the voice of the angel of the Lord, who encourages the shepherds to fear not. For he brings good news of a Savior born this day, a Savior who is Christ the Lord. Go to the manger, where they will find the baby wrapped in swaddling clothes. As the shepherds leave, the skies are filled with a multitude of angels saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace, goodwill to all men."
Oh,
The shepherds rush to the manger and fall on their knees in worship, for this child is Christ the Lord. Looking at that star. They're riding on camels, using the star as a guide to lead them to the Christ child. Who are these three men that follow the star?
We three kings of Orient are, bearing gifts, we traverse afar. Field and fountain, moor and mountain, following yonder star.
Yes, those three men are the three wise men. The new star leads them straight to Bethlehem, where they meet baby Jesus. There, the three wise men present the first Christmas gifts ever given to anyone. Gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And they too fall on their knees to worship him. But why would these noble men bow down to worship a child? Because you see, this is no ordinary child. This child is God's gift to us. He has brought us the gospel of love and peace. He has come to set the captive free. He has come to bring salvation for you and for me. That is why we celebrate this night called Christmas. So let's join our hearts in worship and praise. Come, let us adore him, for he is Christ the Lord.
Truly he taught us to love one another. His law is love, and his gospel is peace. Chains shall he break, for the slave is our brother, and in his name all oppression shall cease. Sweet hymns of joy in grateful chorus raise we, let all within us praise his holy name.
It was a night that changed all human history on this side, BC. On this side, AD. And no matter how secular the government or how politically correct the company, every single day that they do business, they acknowledge the existence and the birth of Jesus Christ by simply doing one thing, putting a date on that check that they write. Where did that date come from? Oh, night divine, where all history was divided. Amen? Hallelujah. I hope you want to take some of the music home with you. Everything we've sung tonight is coming from an album called A True Family Christmas. Even includes the story of the first Christmas, which you just heard. Those are out there and available, and I hope you want to take some of those home with you. Maybe give some as gifts this Christmas. Also, this past year in March, at the very beginning of the pandemic, we did a live stream concert on a Sunday night, not knowing while we were doing that concert that we were recording a new recording. We had no plan to make a recording, but the pandemic had just started. We had been in King, Texas, and we drove those 24 hours back home, and while the bus was driving, my phone was ringing, and emails and texts were coming in, and 8 months of concerts were gone in just a matter of short amount of time because of what was going on. One of the first things we said to each other, what can we do to give back? What can we do? We're great friends with the Billy Graham Association. We sing there every year at the Cove in Asheville, North Carolina, the Billy Graham Training Center. So I made a quick phone call down to the lady that we work with all the time down there, and she said to me, you want to do what? I said, we'd like to do a live stream concert and have a donate button and let folks give to Samaritan's Purse. Because that was the week Samaritan's Purse was going to New York City. They were setting up those hospitals in New York City right in Central Park. She said, I'll call you back. And she made a quick phone call. Well, she didn't end up calling me back. Franklin Graham's assistant did and called me back. And we set up a partnership. And that night when we went to sing, there was a donate button. Facebook had it set up. Was set up so it went directly to Samaritan's Purse. Our office didn't have anything to do with it. It was just direct there. They advertised it. We advertised it. And I remember just before we went on that night, I looked at the team and I said, let's pray the Lord helps these folks give $10,000 tonight. Kim looked at me and laughed. She said, oh, ye of little faith, I'm praying for $50,000. I said, whoa. The girl said, I think $25,000. I said, well, let's just grab hands and pray and ask God that his people will do what he wants them to do. And we began singing. 8 o'clock it came on, and we sang for an hour and a half. It was a wonderful time. Just the six of us in the room around the piano, and then our team back there, they were running the cameras and the audio. It was a great time. And when we finished, I said to William, hey, click on there and see what the stats are coming in from Facebook. We were all surprised. 200,000 people had clicked and watched that hour and a half. But I tell you what the biggest surprise was, they gave $234,000 to Samaritan's Purse. Woo! I can hear Kim's words ringing in my ear. Oh, ye of little faith. Next morning, my phone rang and I looked and it said Samaritan's Purse. When I said hello, boy, I recognized Franklin Graham's voice on the other end. Phil, the Lord really helped what you guys did last night. And I said, well, it certainly wasn't us, but God's people were incredibly generous. Well, it made a recording called Worship from Home. It's both in a high-definition video or audio CD, and those are back there. And it comes right from that night on March the 29th when we did the live stream concert. Another brand new video has released this year in 2020, right in the middle of the pandemic. We filmed it last year over at the Ark. Everybody knows where the Ark is down in Williamstown, Kentucky. We have a three-day event called Inspiration Encounter, and we filmed a live video there last year called Mercy and Love, live from Inspiration. So those are out there that are new this year. And by the way, everybody here tonight is invited to Inspiration Encounter, which will take place in the spring. Of course, we couldn't do it in October of this year. So during spring break, April 8, 9, and 10, Pastor Jim Cimbala, Larnell Harris, the Collingsworth family, the Booth brothers, Greater Vision, Gordon Moat, and Ken Davis, and 81 members of Kim's immediate family are going to be there. Her mom and dad, they had 9 children, 9 in-law children, 41 grandchildren, 41 great-grandchildren, and they're not Catholics, and they've got all this crew. So 81 of those family members are going to be there on Saturday morning. We'd love to have you come and join. It gives you free entrances to the Creation Museum and to the Ark those 3 days. And come and join us. There'll be 5 sessions. It's going to be a wonderful time. The brochures are out there. Make a great Christmas gift for somebody. And at the beginning of this pandemic, Kim did something that I've seen her do several times before. She loves to organize. And the best time on the planet for her to organize is just after she's seen an edition of the Hoarders show. I mean, as soon as that show goes off, she's got the drawers out. She's got the closet. I mean, she's going at it. Well, she decided pandemic was perfect time since we were home to take 25 years of journals that she has written across the last 25 years, and she would organize all of that. In that process, her and her sister Becky, who is here tonight, got talking, and they said, boy, if you ever get the opportunity to write a book, this is the opportunity. And they jumped in, and 8 months later, it's here. A beautiful book called His Gift, My Story. Those of you who know Kim know her piano playing ability is a gift from God. It did not come through piano lessons from a piano teacher. It came through a prayer at age 3 years old, and she tells the entire story. There's a lot of interesting stuff in that book. Tales You'll Never Hear from the Stage is one of the chapters in this book. Matter of fact, she and I have about 800 letters or so that we wrote to each other. Now, back in the ancient days when Noah had just finished the ark, she and I were dating. And they didn't have anything called texting or emailing. They didn't have any of those kind of things. So you wrote each other old-fashioned handwritten letters. We've got about 800 of those. We put 2 in the book, the very first one I ever sent her and the very first one she ever sent me, and that's the only 2 you're going to get to see. But they're in the book. And it's a beautiful, beautiful hardbound, beautiful cover on it. Those are out there. And I hope you want to take a bunch of those books home. Folks have been really picking those books up in the last 2 weeks that they've been out. Wow, I'm overwhelmed at how many they've taken. And so I hope you want to take some of those home. Matter of fact, Michael has set up a beautiful gift bag back there of the 5 newest things from the Collingsworth family. It does include Kim's book, includes a beautiful coffee mug, has the Christmas CD, has the new Worship from Home CD, and has that brand new DVD from the Ark called Mercy and Love. 5 items in there for $65. He's already got them all packaged, got the beautiful tissue in it, all that stuff. So if you'd like to have some of those, make sure you go back there. Most of you know how we like to do it on the Lord's Day. I hate to have a flea market going on back there. If you want something, take it home with you today. And Danette, our office manager, she'll send you an invoice in the mail, and you can take care of it, the business part of it later on. You can go on our website, use a credit card, take care of the invoice. But we'd love for you to take a lot of these things home with you. The books that are in the gift packages have been personally signed by Kim. So she signed a ton of those today, and they're back there and available. Hope you'll want to take a bunch of this stuff home with you. In the second portion of the program, we're going to do just a short portion more and some very interesting Christmas songs, and then you get the chance to have Kim play on this piano any Christmas song you want to hear before we go home tonight, so that'll be exciting. Pastor Bob is around here somewhere. Here he comes, and he's going to take care of the offering and then let you go for a 15, 20-minute break. Thanks, Bob.
All right. Well, thank you. Have you been blessed? Amen. Let's just give him a round of applause again. Thank you for ministry, being here with us this evening. Well, if you have been blessed, and we certainly want to be a blessing to them, and we are going to take up a love offering, but obviously we're not allowed to pass any of the offering plates. And so when you leave the sanctuary, there are some chests that are at each of the doors, and you can drop in your love offering into those chests, and everything that you give tonight will go to the Collingsworth family. You can also give online. If you just go to our church website, www.fbcge.org/concerts, it'll take you right to a Collingsworth family page, and right there on that page is a place where you can give online as well. And everything that you give tonight, either online or through just giving tonight in the chest, goes right to the Collingsworth family. And we're so glad that we're able to be a blessing to them, as we have certainly been blessed. I've been blessed. I know that you have as well. It's amazing the talent that God has given this family, and we're so thankful that we could have them here tonight for this Christmas concert. I also just wanted to mention for our church family here at First Baptist Church of Glen Estee, on behalf of our church family, thank you for visiting here with us. Many of you are visiting, and we're glad that you're here. Thank you for all of you that are watching online as well. I hope that you've been blessed. And then we have been praying for our pastor and Miss Joy. She had surgery 4 weeks ago, a very serious surgery. And yesterday she was able to travel home from the James Center, and she's at home tonight, and Pastor's right here with us tonight. And so let's thank God for Pastor and Miss Joy. And Pastor, we have been praying for you. We've been praying for Miss Joy. And as a church family, we're going to continue to pray, because we know this is still a long road and a long journey, but we know that God is going to give you the grace and the strength and sustain you as he has. And so I hope that you sense the presence of God in the prayers of your church family who love you dearly. I did hear this, and I don't know if I can share this or not, but I'm going to. So I may be in his office later, I don't know. But I did hear that on their way here from Columbus home, that they had to stop by the church and just see the church, because they miss this place so much. And I tell you, we miss you as well. And we're so glad that that we're able to have you here tonight in our presence. And so, well, Brother Collingsworth mentioned to you that we're going to have an intermission, but he did ask me just to share a brief message with you. And so I want to do that. And as I think about Christmas, one of the things that I think about, and I'm sure you do as well, is just family. Family and friends. In fact, you're here tonight, you're probably sitting with somebody that is your family or a friend, right? And when we think about Christmas, we think about family. And for some, that means that Christmas is a joyful time. It means Christmas is exciting and you're thrilled to get together with your family. Then there, for others, maybe it's a difficult season. Maybe during the holiday season for you, because of your family, maybe it's a little bit more difficult. But regardless, we think about family during Christmas time. I remember when I was 13 years old, my parents divorced, and I remember the very first Christmas after my parents divorced and how difficult that Christmas celebration was, because it was now different, and it was just strange, and it wasn't the way that I remembered as a little boy growing up. And now I had to do multiple Christmases at different homes, and it was just very difficult. And so I understand that for some Christmas is difficult, and for others Christmas is very exciting. But we all know that we can have the joy in our hearts at Christmas because of the Lord Jesus Christ. They've been singing about the Lord Jesus, and we've been celebrating him and the name of Jesus. And so I want to draw your attention just to two verses, and we'll be done. I'll make a few comments. Matthew chapter 1, verse 21 and 23, we read these words. And she shall bear a son, Mary shall bear a son, and she shall call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. And jump down to verse 23. Behold, the virgin shall conceive in her womb, and will bear a son, and they will call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. In these two verses, there are two names that describe our Savior. The first one is the name Jesus, and if you look at that name Jesus, that precious name, the name Jesus, it means Jehovah is salvation. Makes sense, because the verse says he shall save his people from their sins. You realize that Jesus came and was born of the Virgin Mary, God in the flesh. Jesus, his deity wrapped in humanity, came to give his life on the cross to pay for your sin and to pay for my sin. But then it also uses the name Emmanuel. You know, this name is only used once in the Bible. It's right here in this verse. It gives us the interpretation. It says right here in the verse, God with us. Hey, listen to this statement. God came to live with us that we might one day live with him. Realize that Jesus came to this earth to be born in the manger, to live his life, a perfect life, to give his life on the cross as a ransom, as an atonement, as a payment for your sin and for mine, so that one day, not just so we could have God spend Christmas with us, but that so one day we could spend an eternity with him in heaven. Well, how does that take place? Well, it's simple. It takes place by acknowledging that you're a sinner in need of a Savior. That's why Jesus came, that he might save his people from their sins. He wants to save you from your sins. And if you acknowledge that you're a sinner and you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, that he is the one who died for you and that he rose again the third day from the grave and offers you forgiveness and eternal life, my friend, you could receive at Christmas this year in 2020, as awful as this year may have been, this could be the best year for you if on this Christmas you receive the greatest gift that's ever been offered to you. It's the gift of eternal life, paid for by the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross, offered to you freely if you would just believe. I wonder if you've accepted that gift. I wonder if you know Jesus as your personal Savior. And when we sing these songs about Christmas, it's not about a holiday. It's not about presents. It's not just about family and friends that you're going to spend the holiday season with. It's about remembering and celebrating and worshiping your Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. I trust he's your Savior. In fact, if he's not, maybe tonight would be the night that you trust him in to be your Savior. I'm going to ask you to bow your head and close your eyes, and I'm just going to have a word of prayer, and then we're going to have an intermission where you can stretch and you can use the restroom, or you can buy the table to look at the merchandise that's for sale. But listen, the greatest decision you could ever make is receive Jesus Christ into your life. With heads bowed and eyes closed, if you're in need of a Savior, if you recognize and you acknowledge that you're a sinner, and you want to place your faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, you can do that right there in your seat. You can do that by just simply, through faith, calling upon God to forgive you and asking Jesus to be your Savior. You say, I don't know what to say. Hey, can I help you? Prayer doesn't save you, but a prayer of faith, expressing your faith through prayer and believing it in your heart and asking God to save you, can have and receive the gift of eternal life right here tonight. So with heads bowed and eyes closed, if you need to receive Jesus, just pray something like this in your heart. Just be honest with God and talk to God and say, Dear God, I'm a sinner, and I know I deserve to pay for my sin. But I believe that Jesus was sent to die on the cross for my sin. And right now, I repent of my sin, and I receive Jesus into my life, and I ask him to be my Savior and to give me the gift of eternal life. My friend, if your head's bowed and eyes closed, if you prayed something like that and by faith you just called upon God to forgive you of your sin and give you the gift of eternal life, according to the word of God, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Have the eternal life. My friend, we rejoice in your decision. I'm going to invite you while we go into intermission. If you pray to receive Christ your Savior, I'm going to be right down here in the front. And if you'd like to come down and just let me know that you made that decision, I'd love to know that, rejoice with you, and even have a short prayer with you to rejoice in that decision that you've made. I invite you to do that. Father, we love you. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity that we have to come and be here together and celebrate Christmas, the birth of our Savior. Lord, I thank you for the Collingsworth family, just the incredible talent that you have given them. But Lord, more importantly, the desire that they have to use the talent and the gifts, abilities that you've given them to bring you glory and to draw people into an understanding of who you are and sharing the gospel across this country. Lord, thank you for last year, the opportunity they had to share Jesus in the White House. And Lord, I just thank you so much for the opportunities you've given this family. Lord, I thank you that we could be here together for this concert. Lord, I pray you bless the rest of our time here with them. Lord, we give you the praise and glory for it. And for anyone here tonight who just prayed to receive Jesus into their life, Lord, I pray that they would let us know. Lord, if somebody did it online, that they would let us know through the online correspondence that they can do. And Father, may we just rejoice with you, knowing that somebody trusted you as Savior this evening. Father, we love you. Thank you for this Christmas season, and we thank you for the opportunity to worship you together. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, you've got a number of minutes now to stretch, to use the restroom, visit the Collingsworth table, and they'll let you know when to come back in here and get ready for the second part of the concert. Thank you.
Thank you. had to slow down and focus on those closest to us. This time of reflection has helped us to realize what is truly important. We've been given extra time with those we love. We've seen the importance of family. We've seen what it's like to struggle and to overcome. But we don't fear tomorrow because we are together.
My favorite Christmas memory is one that happened a little bit more recently. When I was a teenager, I had a golden retriever dog that was unfortunately tragically killed, and I hadn't had a dog for quite some time, and my wife bought me, about 3 years into our marriage, she bought me a golden retriever puppy, and we've had him for about 2 years now, and his name is Toby, and he's just the most beautiful thing you ever saw, and so happy to see you every time you come running. So that's probably my favorite Christmas memory to date.
One of the funniest Christmas memories I can remember was when I was about 14 or 15 years old. Me and my mom decided to set up the Christmas tree late at night, and no one else was involved for some reason or another, and we set the Christmas tree up and we got it all done, and it looked crooked. So my mom said, you hold the tree, I'll lay underneath of it and fix the stand. So she's trying to straighten it, and I thought she said, let go. Well, what she said was, don't let go. I let go of the tree, it literally snapped, the base snapped, it fell on top of my mom. And we laid there, it was in the floor, she was laughing with the tree on top of her, and we laid there laughing for a very long time, and we had to make a midnight trip to go get a new Christmas tree stand. So one of my favorite Christmas memories, we started, more like a tradition, we started it when I was a kid. I was probably 2 or 3 years old, and we would, on Christmas Eve, we would stop all of our festivities, whatever we were doing, and we would get our hats and coats on, and we would go downtown to Christmas Carol at our local hospital. And back then, they would let us go to all 9 floors, and we would go just walk through every hallway and Christmas Carol to all the people that were sick in the hospital. And a lot of them didn't even have visitors on Christmas Eve, so they would ask us to come in their rooms, and we would Christmas Carol to them. And one of my favorite memories from doing that was we got to go to the maternity ward where all the newborn babies were. And we were actually singing Silent Night, and a young new dad came out with his little boy, and we were singing Silent Night, and he holds it up like it was the Christ child. So that was one of my very favorite Christmas memories from when I was a kid.
Phil and I started a tradition where we would go to the bakery, and I would buy a cake before Christmas Sunday. And the lady, I'll never forget one time, the lady at the bakery said, now, whose name do you want on the cake? And I said, well, I wanted to say happy birthday, Jesus. She kind of looked at me and she said, okay. But the neatest thing was I would take that birthday cake home, and on Christmas morning, we would put that, or Christmas dinner, we would put that cake in the middle of the table, and we would all sing the song, happy birthday, Jesus. I'm so glad it's Christmas. All the tinsel and lights and the presents are nice, but the real gift is you. And that was a very special memory for me. It was kind of surreal. Listening, the kids got quiet, and it was just kind of settling in their minds that this is really why we celebrate. We have all this other fun, but this is the real reason. So that's a very special memory for me as a mom raising my kids, and one I will always cherish.
One of my favorite Christmas memories is from December 2010, and I got married in that December, and my husband and I got married 15 days before Christmas, and we had a Christmassy wedding. We came home and we had slim pickings of Christmas trees because it was almost Christmas. It was like 6 days before Christmas, and so we went and got our little Charlie Brown tree, and we were in a little basement apartment. It wasn't much, but I will never forget it. It was a cozy Christmas, our first one together.
My favorite memory as a child and Christmas was always on Christmas Eve. After we had opened most all of our gifts, we usually saved one for Christmas morning, but most of our gifts were opened at midnight. I waited for it every year. The Haven of Rest radio broadcast put on a very good, dramatic Christmas show on the radio. We were big radio people. And I can remember many years laying at the foot of the Christmas tree. My mom and dad's big console stereo was right there, and we were on the right station because the Haven of Rest broadcast would come on at midnight and it would start. And I knew that was the moment that Christmas started, official Christmas Day, and it was a 30-minute dramatic presentation, and some of those were really scary and really good. And so I can just remember that as one of the coziest memories of laying in front of the Christmas tree, waiting for that midnight to hit when the Haven of Rest broadcast would come on.
Homecoming, and that merry yuletide spirit in me.
Well, you have no idea how good it is for our family to be in our hometown on the last night of our Christmas tour, for more reasons than one, as you know. But this is an honor and a privilege. Back in February, Pastor Brent and his wife Joy went out to dinner together. We do that occasionally, and we were sitting there talking, and Joy piped up and said, "Brent, can I tell him my dream?" And he said, "Go ahead." And she said, "I want y'all to come and do a Christmas concert at our church and give our team a break just 1 year." And Phil said, "Well, we're going to be on the West Coast this year, and so it wouldn't work this year, but maybe next year." We were already out in the parking lot, and it was dark, and we were just standing there talking. And little did we know, that was February, what would happen in March. And then all that has transpired over the last 9 months, and COVID, and yes, all of that. And our slate started getting wiped away. And 85 concerts later that canceled, somehow Brent and Phil got together, and Phil said, "I don't think we're going to the West Coast after all. I don't think California would let us in right now." And so here we are tonight. But God knew all that would transpire and knew that this was the right thing. And so we are honored to be here. And I mean that with all of my heart. So thank you for the invitation. And what a year, huh? Kind of crazy. But I got to be honest, I really did think this tour would also get canceled. And a few dates did. But as soon as they would get canceled, somebody would literally call the office and say, "Is there any chance that you could come to our place?" And honestly, the tour kept getting canceled and filling back up, and then it'd get canceled and fill back up. So we had a full tour, but I did go to Phil, and I said, "Listen, I'm kind of the bean counter," and I said, "You know, because of COVID and because we've been home a lot this year, don't you think we just should probably strike a lot of the stuff we had planned for Christmas tour? You know, let's don't do the screens, let's don't do the lights, let's don't do any of that stuff." And Phil looked at me like I had three heads. He said, "Kim," he said, "absolutely not." He said, "These people are depressed." He said, "Why would we shrink Christmas?" And I kind of looked at him, I'm like, "Okay." He said, "Actually, we're going to take it up a notch." I was like, "Are you kidding me?" And he said, "No, well, you'd have to know Phil to understand that. He's the visionary and the dreamer." And I hang on to his coattail going, "Jesus, help us, catch us. Here we come." But I was like, "Okay, all right, if you think so." And I'm not kidding. I want to stop for a moment and just say something that is not planned. But we have a team traveling with us on this tour that has been incredible. These are people that their tours got canceled, and they haven't worked a lot this year, but are they ever more good at what they do? But our son, Philip, has headed up everything that you see. And I'm telling you, I just want to say this again, and they're going to all think I'm out of line, but you can just deal with it because we write you the check. So, but I want to say, Philip, listen. Unbelievable. Unbelievable what you've done. And Dad and I just look on in amazement. Back in the day, it was just Phil and me. He drove the bus, and then when he couldn't drive any longer because he was about to kill us because he was falling asleep, he called me one night in the back of the bus and said, "Kim, I need help." And I said, "With what?" And he said, "I'm going to kill us." He said, "I'm falling asleep, and we have to keep driving to get to the next venue." And I was like, "What does that mean?" And he said, "Have you ever driven a bus?" I said, "Never." And he knew that. And anyway, he said, "Kim, honestly, you got to help me." So I won't even indulge with that story, but we survived because we're here, but only by a wing and a prayer. But it used to be just us, and now we have this kid over here. He's not a kid, and I know that, but he'll always be my kid. But he has worked tirelessly behind the scenes, and his crew, let's just start. William Blair, sitting over here at the soundboard. Unbelievable. He's front of house engineer. Unbelievable. Thank you, William. Thank you. Our son-in-law, Michael Metz, who is also Courtney's husband. He's head of all the media. Everything you see on these screens, honestly, he surprised us a couple nights, and it's been amazing. Thank you, Michael. Michael. Kyle Bates, he actually runs all of Bill Gaither's organization, but Bill Gaither has been home, obviously, due to COVID, and so he jumped on the team, and every bit of the lights that you see tonight, that's Kyle Bates. So Kyle, thank you so much. You don't see Robert Dixon, who is running around and literally, what would you call him? He's the stage manager, okay? And he is the one that comes at quarter till to say to all of us women, you have 15 minutes to be ready. And he's really sweet, but he cracks the whip in the nicest way you've ever seen. And he gets us where we need to go. And Robert Dixon, wherever you are, there he is! Thank you so much. Oh, man, what a privilege. Thank you. I know I'm taking a little bit of time, but let me tell you something. I hate it when people don't thank people until they're gone. That's wrong. That's just so wrong. So that's why I'm doing this. Help me here. Oh, I want to talk about Zach Crater. Where are you at? Wave at me. He's up there, and he has helped tremendously with tearing down and setting up, and I don't know what all. Zach, thank you so much. And then Charlenae Collingsworth, our daughter-in-law, has run all product. You just have to see her do it to know what a job it is. And that's Michael's job normally. He came to me and said, Kim, I can't do that and do media and do everything else I got to do on this tour. So Char said, hey, I'm in. And Michael came to me the other night and he said, she is killing it. And I said, that's great. And she has done an amazing job. So Charlenae, thank you, thank you, thank you. I don't know where you're at. Emily Rains is our social media manager and our nanny on the road. We call her Mary Poppins. You'd have to understand her personality. She's a Mary Poppins. She runs around. The only thing she's missing is her umbrella. But she's got that smile and the happy. So, Emily, thank you. And then last but certainly not least are the bus drivers. Mm-mm-mm. We have two buses now. If you came in on this side, you saw. And you know, Lowell Levy, our brother-in-law. Lowell, where are you? He's right there. Lowell Levy gets us safely everywhere we go. And we are now, when we got the second bus, this is the first tour with two buses. And Phil said, I've got this guy that I want to drive. I said, how old is he? And he said, I think about 25. And I said, what? JV, where are you? Wow. This guy, I want to say kid. I don't know where he is. He's not a kid. He's married. Oh, my God. Wherever you're at, dear me. Anyway, he's up top. I see him. Okay. He drove our bus. And for us to let a 20-some-year-old guy drive us all over while we're sleeping through the night scared the daylights out of me. But I literally have slept very well on this trip. That's a good thing. So, and I'll tell you one more thing. Vestal Goodman used to put a cup of water on the dash, and she'd tell the test driver, if you spill one drop out of there, you don't get the job. No pressure. But JV, you've done phenomenal. Thank you. And that, I just wanted to say a big thank you to the whole entire crew. Tom Taylor, if you're here, he jumped in when Lowell couldn't go and drove about four nights for us. Thank you again. So we're blessed and we're better together. You know what I'm saying? In a church, a work, or this kind of a ministry, teamwork, there's nothing like that. And so I'm so grateful and so, so blessed. I know I took a little time, but I felt like it was necessary. It's kind of bittersweet. I heard the crew saying tonight, I'm sad. I'm sad this is over. So that means it's been a good tour. Philip Yancey is a writer that I absolutely love to read after. And I read recently that one Christmas, he went to London for Christmas to hear the Handel's Messiah. Wouldn't that be something? And he said, the day of the performance, he said, I spent the morning touring London. And he said, I was looking at all of England's glory. He said, I saw gilded carriages. I saw a gold mace. He said, I saw the crown jewels. And he said, while I was in London, he said, I watched how rulers stride through this world. Bodyguards, trumpet fanfares, bright clothes, flashy jewelry. He said it was amazing to see. Royalty. And he said, while I was there, he said, I had just read recently an article of where Queen Elizabeth had come to the United States. And he said, when she came to the United States, he said, the U.S. rolled out the red carpet for her. And he said, literally, she came to the U.S. with 4,000 pounds of luggage. Ladies, did you hear me? How many pounds do we get when we go on an airline? 50. And I promise you, if my suitcase has 51, they make me take something out of it. She came with 4,000 pounds of luggage, 2 outfits for every occasion, they said. She had her own hairdresser and many, many bodyguards and a host of attendants to meet her every need. It's fascinating. And Philip Yancey said, as I thought about that while I was in London, he said, it made me start thinking of how Jesus came to this world. No attendants, no bodyguards. The angels lit up the sky to announce his coming, but who saw it? Some lowly shepherds on a hillside. We don't even know who they were because they didn't even leave their names. He came in the most humble way. Bill and Gloria Gaither wrote a song one time that said he was just an ordinary baby. That's the way he planned it, maybe, so that we would come to him and not be afraid. With no airs of condescension, he became God's pure extension, giving us the chance to be remade. I don't know why he came as a baby. I don't know. I like to think that if that were me and I had that position, I'd come with all the regal and the royal royalty that I could muster up, but not Jesus. I heard someone once say, how do you determine the value of something? And the answer was, by the price someone is willing to pay. And I think of how Jesus came and what he left. He left splendor and glory. He left it all to come down here. This God who could rule armies and empires and move them around like pawns on a chessboard emerged into this world as a baby, a helpless baby. He was dependent upon a teenage couple for love and shelter. No place to lay his head. They put him in a feeding trough. He was born in an animal shelter. I don't know why he came that way. But I know this. His coming has made all the difference in the world. And you know what else? I've been thinking about this week. Because last year... Well, let me just tell you this. It made me think of my little niece. I have family here, and they understand this story. It made me think of my little niece, Cheyenne. Some of you know about her, who was so, so broken. My brother's daughter, so broken. A heroin addict all through her teen years. But because Jesus came to this world for people like Cheyenne, the broken, the hurting, the wounded, the shamed, the unloved, because of that, Cheyenne found her way to Jesus. And she went through drug rehab and the whole nine yards. But let me tell you this, she lived 18 months 100% clean. She got baptized, was singing in the choir, going to my brother's church in Virginia. And last August, a year ago, she was tragically killed in a car accident. So sad, taken way too soon from us. But I will tell you this, because Jesus came to this world for people like that, Cheyenne will have a Christmas like nothing we have ever experienced in our life, because she's literally in the presence of the Messiah. Philip Brooks was in Bethlehem. You don't know who Philip Brooks is, probably. You probably don't recognize his name, but you will recognize what he wrote. He was in Bethlehem in 1865. And he said, I was going to the different places, and I was pondering why he came this way. Why did he come in such a lowly way? And he penned these words, how silently. The wondrous gift was given. But God imparts to human hearts the message of his heaven. No ear may hear his coming, but in this world of sin, where meek souls will receive him, the dear Christ enters in. So many times we see the unloved, we see the broken, and we say, isn't that awful? That's really too bad they made all those bad decisions. That's really sad that they've made that kind of a bed and now they've got to lie in it. And Jesus says, no, you're missing the mark. That's who I came for. That's who I came for. Yes, he came for the rich, but he came for the poor. He came for the great, but he came for the lowly. He came for everybody. And I heard someone say one time, you can read from Genesis to Revelation, and you'll never find one time where Jesus was in a hurry. They said Jesus' ministry was always the person standing in front of him. And I thought to myself, oh my goodness, sometimes the person standing in front of me is like an obstacle to keep me from where I think I need to go. And Jesus said, no. And whoever was in front of him, that became his ministry. I think that speaks volumes to us tonight. In the midst of COVID, in the midst of crazy in this world, God's power hasn't diminished to heal the broken. God's love has not changed. His joy has not been canceled. And we have so much to rejoice about tonight. Aren't you glad he came? Aren't you glad he came tonight? Thank you, Jesus, for coming to this world.
Strong and for the weak. time has come and gone quickly, and I know I promised you that Kim would play something just for you tonight, so we're going to do that in a moment. I do want to say a big thank you to our corporate sponsors, Renewa Nation. You saw their videos earlier. I hope you'll go by and take their Renewa Nation magazine out there. They're free of charge, has a bunch of wonderful articles, a lot of them about our family, and also articles about what's going on at Renewa Nation. It's been very interesting things on training children in a biblical worldview. So please go by and grab that magazine. They're free of charge. Take it home with you tonight. And a special shout out, all you've seen and enjoyed tonight in the lights, in the screens, that is all being underwritten by a company called Christian Healthcare Ministries. And I think we should say a big thank you to Christian Healthcare Ministries for their support tonight and throughout the entire tour. If you have healthcare needs that your insurance is not taking care of, or your insurance has just gotten way too expensive, I would heartily and personally recommend Christian Healthcare Ministries. They have covered our family for many years. They paid for all these grandkids, let me tell you. And it is much less expensive than typical health insurance. 480,000 households are covered with Christian Healthcare Ministries, and they share each other's medical needs every month by the millions of dollars. And it's an amazing program. There's a pack it out there. You can take it home with you and just spend some time looking over it, getting some information, how it might fit your budget a lot more. And they have been wonderful to the Collingsworth family. Thank you, Christian Healthcare. Thank you so much. So what would you like to hear Kim play tonight? I don't want you to be bashful. I want to hear any Christmas song you'd love to hear Kim play before we go home tonight. I love that. Ring the bells, let the whole... We know Harry that wrote that. From Word of Life. That's a beautiful song. I heard something over here. Was it Silent Night? Oh, Holy Night. Mary, did you know? The Hallelujah Chorus. Yes, Jeffrey. We got to get that in there. What else? The Charlie Brown Christmas. Oh, yes. Hey, I know what I want to go right with that. My favorite, now I told you what my favorite Christmas carol was, but I have a favorite Christmas song. I want a hippopotamus for Christmas. I love that song for some reason. Matter of fact, I told that the other night, and some lady went to a Hallmark store and come back with me a hippopotamus to sleep with at night. Crazy. I'm not going to step in that, let me tell you. What else would you like to hear, Kim? What child is this? I love that. The Little Drummer Boy. What was it? That's what I thought. That's he said. That's the reason I asked twice. Grandma got run over by a reindeer. This is going to get really fun. I heard the Grinch and I heard Jingle Bells. Go Tell It on the Mountain. I love that. You know what? What was it? I heard a little voice. What did they say? Rudolph. Rudolph. Well, Kim, this is going to go from Dan to Beersheba, so you better get started, girl.
your baby boy will one day walk on water, Mary. Did you know that your baby boy will save our sons and daughters? Did you
did you know?